And now it's time for more of Southern California's sports fishing voice, Let's Talk Hookup. This portion of the show is sponsored in part by Ford, the official truck of Let's Talk Hookup, Shimano Rods and Reels, fish with the best, Shimano, and by Yamaha Outboards, official motor sponsor of Let's Talk Hookup. Here we go. Another great hour of Southern California's sports fishing voice, Let's Talk Hookup. Here's Pete Gray, Rock Cod Rick Mexa, and Corey Sandin.
And welcome back. Hour number two, Let's Talk Hookup, right here on the Let's Talk Hookup app and the Mightier 1090 ESPN Radio. Pete Gray here along with Corey Sandin. We're here in the world headquarters of Let's Talk Hookup, right next to the San Diego Landings in Point Loma. Sean Sullivan, expert photographer, adventurer, author, and super nice guy, and really knowledgeable show here. We're kind of a different slant today, but it's been fascinating.
Different, interesting, and super informative, and just a lot of fun, and talking destinations, and even if you're not even into photography, I mean, dude, everybody's got an Instagram and wants to take good pictures and whatever, right? Yeah. Even at a low level, man. And so if you want to join us, a couple ways to do it, as always, 213-432-1090, or you can text us via the app, and you definitely want to make sure you include on the texting your name and telephone number, a way to contact you, because at the end of the show, Sean Sullivan, so cool, has brought a book, his book, Drawn to Water.
Yes.
And this book is one of the coolest, like,
super cool.
Would you call it a tabletop, like coffee table?
Yeah, coffee table book. It's almost 300 pages, 287 pages.
It's a thick book.
How many different stories?
I think I've got 16 different destination stories in there.
Wow.
New Zealand, Australia, Guadalupe, you know, Cabo San Lucas. I try to
Belize.
Yeah, Belize is in there.
Florida.
Yeah, I did a lot of time in Florida. There's some interesting stuff in there. Love Florida fishing. A lot of fish out there. A lot of great anglers in that area. A lot of great people doing their thing over there.
How does one get a book? Like, if they don't win it today on the show, we're giving away one on the show to a lucky caller or a texter.
Yeah.
Which will be signed, actually.
Yes.
Sean's going to, for the winner, he's going to give it a little personal touch and sign it.
So if you want to order the book, the best way to do it is to go on Amazon. You know, a lot of people have varying opinions of Amazon. Some people love it. Some people hate it. The bottom line is Amazon is convenient.
Right.
They also own KDP, the platform that prints the book. So the best and easiest way to get the book is...
How much is the book?
The book is $49.
That's it?
Yeah, I've tried to keep the price down.
I would have thought that book was $100.
Right.
I mean, it's a beautiful book.
Prices are going to go up soon, so you best get on it. But go on Amazon, punch in Sean Sullivan, Drawn to Water, and it'll come right up. I have three other books up there. I have my skateboard photography book, Barge at Will. I also have lines, my classic snowboarding photos. And then I recently put out another book called The Money Shot, which The Money Shot is an educational text that basically has 20 or so photos in there, and I dedicate several pages to each photo of how I got the photo, techniques I used, different things like what kind of role luck plays in getting a great photo.
So a little tutorial on how to be a better photographer.
Exactly. I took 20 of my best photos, and I wrote out, you know, how did I get this shot? You know?
Oh, that's cool.
Sort of the risks that I took.
And what's the name of that book?
It's called The Money Shot.
The Money Shot. Okay.
Yeah. So it covers the gamut. There's some snowboarding, some fishing, some skateboarding, just some beautiful scenery and stuff like that. So I think that's a great book that I would love to see more people pick up that book, because there's so much to learn that I put. I put a lot of secrets in there.
So put in Sean Sullivan, Drawn to Water. You'll see a lot, all that stuff. And then you'll be at a book signing tomorrow night at Melton's.
That's right. I will be in Newport Beach at the Melton Tackle there. It used to be called the Angler Center. I'll be there from 4 to 6 p.m. signing books.
It's right on Newport Boulevard
That's right. Yeah, it's on Old Newport, one block over from Newport Boulevard. But, you know, you can't miss it. There's big signs everywhere. I'll be there from 4 to 6 p.m. I'll have a stack of books there. I'll be answering questions, talking to anybody who shows up. I hope some people come, because I'm excited to talk about the book and talk about fishing and get into it with some people.
And then you'll be wandering around PCS today. So.
That's right. I will be wandering around.
Told you to go see Valerie at Queen Charlotte Safaris. Meet wonderful lady. She'll be there and touting Haida Gwaii. We're talking about all these wonderful places that you get to visit, and certainly Haida Gwaii is one that should be on the list.
Magical.
Yeah, for sure. New Zealand is one of the ones that's in the book, and I've been to New Zealand catching the big yellowtail. What a magical place, right?
You had a question earlier from somebody asking me about what one of my favorite or most wild places was, and and New Zealand ranks right up there. You know, previously I mentioned the Great Barrier Reef, but that was a pelagic trip that we did. But I took a week of vacation time and put that on the front of our Australia trip and went to New Zealand by myself. I did a solo mission there. And I'd been there before to shoot snowboarding on the South Island, but I had never gone to really have my hand at fishing. And there's an article here in the book that talks about Zane Grey wrote a book years and years, the Angler's El Dorado. If you have a chance, I used to check it out from the library, but it's an absolutely magical text. I checked this book out when I was 12 years old, and I read that thing so many times. I probably checked it out 10 different times over the course of several years when I was a kid. It really inspired me.
The Angler's El Dorado.
The Angler's El Dorado is a Zane Grey classic where he talks about all his fishing adventures. And one of the places he goes in that book is Widianga. And Widianga is right on Mercury Bay, and Mercury Bay is a great spot for these giant yellowtail. And the yellowtail they have down there, it's technically a different species genetically, but it's much like the California yellowtail, almost identical but not quite. If you were to hold up the two species next to each other, you would notice a few differences. Their head is a little blunter sometimes, or a little, it's just different. They look slightly different, but man, they are very much like our yellowtail here. They're a little more protected down there, so the fish have a tendency to get bigger. The world record on the southern yellowtail, I think, is 10 or 15 pounds heavier than the California yellowtail. But in general, on average, the yellowtail you catch down there are 10 to 20 pounds bigger than the yellowtail you get here.
That's crazy.
Yeah. So an average-sized fish down there is going to be 35 to 40. And then if you can get one that's up around 60, 70, that's kind of a trophy down there. Whereas if you get one here in California, you get a 70-pound yellowtail here in California.
Oh, Lord. Come on.
You get one of those a year, maybe.
Yeah. Guadalupe.
Guadalupe.
You have to go to Guadalupe to get a fish like that. Or a Lijos, maybe.
I was fortunate enough to go down there with Jack Nielsen, our dear friend, and Tom Ward from the Longfin.
To New Zealand.
To New Zealand and fish down there with a former San Diego captain at White Island, which is the one they blew up.
Okay.
And you're not allowed to fish there anymore because it blows up, I guess. But we caught a 95-pounder.
Wow.
And I caught several, like 50, 55-pounders, all released. And the 50-pounders were... like, oh, that's a nice one. It's not even a big deal,
no,
right? Yeah, yeah. But when you got one that was like 65?
Yeah, it was just under 65 pounds and an absolute monster, though. Like, when you're used to catching these California yellowtail and a fish like that comes up next to the boat, you're like, holy cow.
Yeah.
You know, I fished with this guy named Owen Wills down there on his boat, the Chaos. Awesome captain. You know, they tend to drive these aluminum boats down there. I think they have some like this up in Alaska, you know, where they have the cabin up front and a little area back, mm-hmm. and they're all metal. Anyway, it's a neat boat. They're fast. But this guy, Owen, he knows that area so well, and he took me to some wild places. One of the things we did was there was this big cave that went in all the way through a rock section, maybe like 50 yards. You can take the boat through there, and when you get on the other side, you end up in this enclosed area.
Like an almost an atoll kind of a situation.
Yeah.
I saw the picture.
Yeah,
it was amazing.
Photos
and this is in the book.
Yeah, it's in the book. I talk about it. There's a bunch of photos in here. You drive through, and you get on the other side, and you get in there, and the water's crystal clear, and it's like a fish tank in there. And it was just such a magical thing to drive all the way through this rocky cave. And he knew the area so well. If you're going to New Zealand and you're looking to go fishing, I would absolutely advise to go, you know, look for New Zealand kingfish, look for Owen Wills. He's a great captain. Their whole operation is awesome.
Wow.
But the yellowtail
and
down there are
and that's
massive.
In the North Island, north part of North Island,
it
right?
It is. The area, I believe, is about, 6 hours from
Auckland,
yep. You got to drive. It's an incredible drive. New Zealand
and the people in New Zealand are just the most wonderful people.
Oh, they're so kind.
And
it's just such a beautiful place.
It's a beautiful place.
Yeah, it's very untrodden compared to a lot of what you see here in the States.
They've kept it special.
They've kept it special, and it's not as populated. You know,
right.
They've got a low population, and it keeps things really clean. And they take a great
and they say come and visit, but then get out.
Yeah,
you know that's kind of their deal there. And that's why it's so nice.
A job
right?
over there.
Yeah, for sure. Hey, Ken is here from the San Diego Anglers. Good morning, Kenton.
Good morning. How are you guys doing?
Great.
Good.
Well, I had some update on the Bay Bass Tournament. Both kayak and boat divisions are open, and you can go to SanDiegoAnglers.com, and there's information under the tournament tab there. You can sign up there. We're about halfway through the boats and halfway through the kayaks, so there's still some spaces available. Only 3 weeks left to sign up. The tournament's on April 6th. We've had a couple of really great sponsors step up. Dave McMullen with Ocean Science Foundation and Rob Butler with Towboat US. So we thank them very much for their contribution to help us put on this great tournament.
Fantastic. Again, the tournament is April 6th, and sign up now at SanDiegoAnglers.com, right?
Yeah, you can go onto that website and click on the OBB tournament tab, and there's information right there where you can click on that. There's a QR code you can scan and get right to the tournament.
Fantastic. Ken, thanks for the information. Good luck with the tournament. Appreciate
you
joining us this morning. Thanks a lot for the call this morning. Let's jump into those phones. And if you want to get through, talk to Sean, have a question, make a comment, 213-432-1090.
And let's talk to Jim. Jim from Morro Bay. Good morning, Jim. Appreciate you joining us this morning.
Hey, Jim.
Hey, good morning, guys. Hey, appreciate you having Sean on the show. And I'm an avid fisherman, but I've been a photographer for the past 50 years, mostly amateur stuff. But great informative show. I got a couple questions. A lot of the fish that are being caught, a lot of guys focus their attention on the bluefin tuna. And the bigger ones, of course, are being caught at night. What is your setup? Does it change much for nighttime photography? That's number one. And number two, when you're... I've gone to Mexico a couple times, and I've kind of wanted to be in the water and taking some shots from in the water, and they were like, absolutely not. We don't allow that. But I'm sure there's maybe some special permits you would get if going down to, like, a mag bay and getting in the water. What's your preferences on that?
A couple of really good questions.
Yeah, so, okay, we'll talk about the first question. Those are great questions. We'll get to the mag bay and the water shooting here next. But first, as far as shooting at night, so, you know, there's two ways to do that, three ways, but it really depends on what kind of boat you're on. If you're on one of the sport boats like the Excel or the Shogun or the Royal or something like that, at night they have these really bright lights that they turn on. And I have come to find that the lights they have make great lighting for shooting night shots. If you get the fish in the right spot and you get a guy holding it up under those lights, you can get some amazing photos that are far superior to trying to shoot with a flash rig.
So you don't even use the flash. You're using only the lights from
available
the boat.
Light.
Yeah. So, you know, I've tried both, and I used to carry this big flash rig on the boat with me sometimes, and I just found it to be hard to deal with because there's so much water splashing around, and, you know, it's electronics, and getting somebody to hold it, and they just, the flashes get thrashed on, and it's just not that effective. I mean, you can light it up kind of cool, but usually the boat's kind of moving, and it's just sort of a pain. I came to find that the photos you would get without it anyway were superior to what I was trying to do with the flash.
Interesting.
So I just stopped carrying the flash on the boat anymore. When I was going on one of those long-range trips, I just decided I didn't really need it anymore. So if you're on a private boat, it's a little bit of a different story. If you don't have really big lights to really light up the scene at night, then you're going to want to carry some sort of flash rig. One of the beautiful parts about that, though, is that if you have, you know, these days a lot of these flashes can fire wirelessly. So if you're willing to make the effort and you know, take on the expense, you can buy these really nice flashes that are triggered from a remote on your camera. You can set those up around the boat and attach them in a way where they're kind of, you know, strapped to the structure of the boat, up on the roof or whatever. So when you do get a fish, you just turn on that sensor and you get the guy to, you know, pose in front of the flashes and get him kind of lined up. You can get some beautiful
really
shots.
Good shots. Yeah,
yeah. Beautiful.
It looks with like backlighting and stuff.
Oh, yeah. I mean, you can do all kinds of crazy stuff where it looks like a studio. And the fact that you're on a private boat, you're not having to deal with all the passengers. You're not having to deal with all the other stuff the things going on around you that make for getting a great photo tough. You can really focus on getting it done.
So those are like you basically can buy a flash with a remote sensor.
Exactly.
And just program all that. What amazing technology.
Yeah, I like to use
today.
Two flashes. If you can get two, it's always going to be better than one. You can light it up from both sides or put one behind them. But
so it's an actual flash versus a light.
Yes, exactly.
What's the advantage of a flash versus I guess you'd call it a strobe versus a light.
So one of the advantages you have, especially at night when you're dealing with low light, is it stops the action.
Uh-huh.
Whereas a light, you know, you're going to have to shoot at a higher shutter speed and try to stop the action.
Strobe's much more intense.
Well, it's fast.
It's fast.
In fact, that's a big issue with flashes is you want to get a flash that has a really short duration. That's how you're able to really stop the action. A lot of these flashes, especially when you're shooting on a really high, intense power level, the flash lasts a long time. It's all boom. You know, it's a slower. If you get a fast duration, it's more like pop, really fast, even when it's bright. You're going to pay more for the faster duration. But that fast duration, that really short blast,
is a cleaner, crisper.
Exactly.
I got you. Yeah. I'm getting it. So where that longer boom, it actually gives you a distorted.
It does. The camera's going to move slightly. The fish is going to move slightly. The shorter the exposure is, the less movement you're going to have. So if you can get a flash with a really short duration, you're going to get much cleaner shots.
So interesting.
Cool. Yeah. Really good. You have a good text?
I do. Actually, he didn't cover the Mag Bay one. Yeah. I want to hear the Mag Bay.
Okay, Bay. That's right. Yeah. Second part of the question. But Jim's question.
Sure. Thanks. So getting in the water with fish, I mean, there's a lot of places where you aren't going to want to do that. You know, you're not going to do that on one of these sport boats. You know, Justin on the Excel is not going to let you jump in with your water camera. You know, that's just not, you know, I think their insurance would probably drop them if they found out, you know, that you were in the water swimming with the
So it would have to be from a private boat.
In Magdalena Bay in particular, I work with this group down there called Mag Bay Whales. You can see them online, magdalenabaywhales.com. They're a great operation. Captain Marcos runs it. He's a local down there. He's been there his whole life. And he's been running these trips where they take you out and you can fish for the marlin that are down there, and you can swim with the marlin. And the whole point of Mag Bay is it's called the sardine run. The sardines gather in that time of year to spawn, and they gather in these huge shoals, these big bait balls. And it draws the marlin in, and you literally get thousands of striped marlin congregating.
Crazy.
In the area. I mean, more marlin. I mean, marlin tend to be relatively solitary in their life, sure. But when that sardine run unfolds, there are so many fish in such a small area. I mean, thousands and thousands of individuals all coming in to try to feed. You get all kinds of other pelagic species. You get Dorado, you'll get some Wahoo, you'll get some other things. But one of the things about going out with Marcos and those guys in Mag Bay is they will let you fish for them if you want, but you can also get in and swim with the marlin, and you can take photos. And so I've tried to do that a few times, getting a great photo of the marlin. I'm sure we've all seen them online, of marlin working the bait ball. You know, it looks really easy on paper, but let me tell you, it's not that easy to get that magnificent,
that,
you know,
shot.
A-grade shot. Those fish are moving so fast. And, you know, the sardine.
So you got to follow on the boat and then jump in at the right moment, right?
You got to be on top of it.
Anticipate it.
Yeah, you got to be ahead of the bait ball. And you got to sort of gauge it for a little bit and figure out which direction the bait ball is moving.
And are the captains that you're riding with, they got it down pretty well?
Oh, yeah. These guys that are working
with. That sounds cool.
They
and you can fish, too?
Yeah, so.
So they'll let you fish?
Yeah, the way I did it is we would fish, and then if we see what we call a static bait ball, which I didn't really understand the meaning of that until we got out there. A static bait ball, as opposed to just a moving bait ball, is one that's sitting in one spot where the marlin have pushed these baits all into one swirling mass, and it's not really moving in any direction. And at that point, it really gives the marlin an opportunity to get in there and feed hard. These marlin, they'll get in there and really tag team these bait balls. You get 20 or 30 marlin around these bait balls, and I mean, they keep it in one area. And if you can find a static bait ball that has a bunch of marlin around it, then you can dive in and sit there for a
minute. They don't mind that you, they don't even pay attention.
No, the marlin won't even mess with you. I mean, they might come up and look at you or investigate you a little bit, or they wonder who the hell you are, but generally speaking, they'll just leave you alone. And I've never heard of anybody getting a spear in the face or anything like that. Although I do mention this in the book, there's a story in here about Mag Bay marlin. I do mention that the idea of swimming with these fish that have a giant, you know, sword poking out at you can be a little unnerving when you're out there. But once you're in the water with them a little bit and you realize that they're really not going to do anything to you, they're more interested in the sardines than they are you. I mean, these aren't toothy predators either. They don't feed on, you know, they don't attack people. They're not out to try to, you know. So
talk about you mentioned the whale coming up in the middle, and unfortunately you didn't have your camera in hand. You had a fishing rod in hand.
Yes.
But that's like added bonus for which, a sight you could see down in Mag Bay.
So I want to start start this little thing by sending out a shout out to Evan Salve. You know, he's a really
Evan's amazing. Champ.
Yeah, he's a great guy.
Evan's he's a champion black Marlin fisherman for the Bisbee.
Former champion Calico Bass fisherman.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
I mean, he has really made an impact in the fishing world these past few years. He's an incredible guy, super smart. Fishy as heck, as more fishy than anybody I've ever known.
Yeah,
he took me down there on a trip, and we were fishing these marlin with these big Daiwa Saltiga stick baits, the big eight inch ones. And he has them rigged up in a way where he's got a fixed hook on him. He's done all kinds of like adjustments and modifications to these big baits. But we're out there fishing them with big jig rods and a Tranks 500 with really heavy line on it. And we would, you know, we were fishing them on the finger bank. So eventually, as the season unfolds, the fish tend to move away from Mag Bay and they move south and they follow the warm water south. They end up on the finger bank, which was a good 2-hour boat ride from Cabo. You get up there and, you know, there was thousands of marlin on the bank when we were there, and there was bait balls everywhere. We were catching these marlin. At one point, though, we came across this bait ball that had a bunch of marlin on it, and they're jumping, and we're fishing on it, and we saw this whale coming in from one side. We could see him over here. We're like, oh, here comes a whale. He disappears for a few minutes, and there was probably more and more marlin were coming in on this huge bait ball. This thing must have been an acre across. I mean, it was absolutely massive, swirling in a big, you know, you could see the water boiling. All of a sudden, this whale comes up from underneath the bait ball. Obviously, I mean, I wasn't in the water to see it, but it comes from underneath it. And he comes out of his head out of the water, and he's got a mouthful of sardines. He's got thousands.
Like almost like a bubble feed.
Oh, yeah. He's got thousands of sardines in his mouth, and they're spilling out the side.
Wow.
And what I deduced was there was something about the whale competing with the marlin for the food that caused the marlin to go completely nuts. The marlin started coming out of the water all around this whale, and as sardines are falling out of this whale's mouth, the marlin are coming up right next to the whale and grabbing these sardines right there. I mean, we're talking,
what a crazy story,
dozens of marlin all
That's
around
amazing.
This whale. I mean, I've never seen Mother Nature in such a crazy moment like that. It's like nothing I've ever seen.
Sean, your descriptions are
really
the
good.
Way your photos are.
Yeah.
The photos in the book, Drawn to Water. I mean, your words of description are exactly your picture.
Right.
Awesome. I'm glad to hear that. You know,
theater of the mind is radio. Radio is the theater of the mind. You depict it so
beautifully.
You're a great radio guy.
I wanted to say one more thing about that. You know, he was asking me about getting in the water with these fish. You know, I use this thing. If you don't want to spend all the money on a big expensive water housing, there's this thing called a G-Dome that you can get online. They're a lot less expensive. They're about, you know, one-fifth the price of the $4,000 water housing. They're not quite as sturdy, but they allow you to get in the water with your camera in a way that
you can take a mirrorless SLR.
Yes, so you can run a mirrorless SLR. It doesn't have to be a GoPro like, you know, a lot of people are using these days. You can actually use the bigger camera with higher resolution and get in there with some shot and get some shots of these marlin.
It's called a G-Dome.
A G-Dome, and you can go online and find it. It's a great device.
You just don't take it deep.
No, it's more of like something like a surf photographer would use. I think you can only go down to like 15 meters or something like that at very most.
Very expensive?
They're $500 or $600, I think.
Yeah.
But they're pretty tech for how cheap they are.
Yes.
And you can get a big, you know, round dome for the front of it. And the guys who run that company, they're down in South Africa, but they're great people. And I had one break on me, and not to say that they always break. They're a great device. But they instantly replaced it for me. They were really cool about it.
Oh, cool.
And so, yeah, if you're wanting to get in the water.
And what lens are you shooting that photo in the water of the marlin with?
I shoot it with a 20mm. You do want a wide angle.
Okay.
The issue with the G-Dome and with most of these water housing cameras is you want to have it set up before you get in the water. You got to set all your settings and your exposure stuff. You can make some adjustments, but it's a lot trickier once that thing's in the housing. So you want to get everything kind of set up before you go in the water. You want to have your focus set where you want it. And once you get that in, you just dive in. And if you can find yourself a static bait ball, get in the water with it for a few minutes, and I guarantee you're going to get something.
Amazing.
That's
amazing. Fantastic
stuff. We've got a guy, Dave Hanson,
that's seen a lot of that.
That has seen static bait balls.
Yeah, yeah. Let's find out what's biting out there. The fishdope.com report from Captain Dave Hanson.
And it's brought to us by... the Fisherman's Processing in San Diego, and you get your premier processing experience from Fisherman's Processing. Check out the new and easier online system to book your processing for your long-range trips. Now, with the addition of the new team members, Fisherman's Processing stays far ahead of the rest. More same-day capacity and the finest customer service. Stop by their location in Old Town on Taylor Street or check fishermansprocessing.com and make your reservations today.
Absolutely. Captain Dave, good morning.
Hey, Pete. Good morning, guys.
Oh, how's that voice? you've been yelling a lot at the PCS show, haven't you?
It's a show voice.
Hard to believe, right, Pete? I'm usually so quiet and calm.
Yeah.
But
I saw what you were doing up on stage. I saw it.
There was a couple people in my booth, yeah, for sure. And then you snuck up on me from behind, but it was great to see you there, Pete.
Yeah, great to see you. And yeah, he had tons of fans surrounding him, Captain Dave Disciples.
Yeah, well, he was just talking about that Mag Bay thing. That is, it's got to be on every fisherman's bucket list. You guys can't even imagine what it looks like. It is the most unbelievable thing, and there's not one bait ball. If you get in the gyros and you look around when it's happening, there's 20 of those exactly the same as how he described it.
Yes.
And you just got to pick which one. Whichever one has the biggest bird school on it is usually the one we go to, and it's pretty National Geographic insane, and I'd love to see that book. I can't wait to check it out and read it, and I'll see you up at the show today. It's going to be crazy again today. Yesterday was absolutely, it looked like Disneyland there, Pete. You couldn't even see concrete anywhere. It was just solid wall-to-wall people. It was the most amazing thing. And then Carl, Air Pelikea, and Lasley spoke, and oh my gosh, the who's who of captains.
Oh, yeah.
Filled the audience. It was pretty spectacular as you looked into the audience and saw Brett McBride Anthony Shea came to watch the seminar. It was pretty spectacular to see Carl and Steve sharing some inside information.
Yeah, for sure.
Those of us that know who those two guys are filled the audience. It was pretty spectacular. But, guys, as far as fishing goes, some really cool videos come through yesterday while I was doing my seminar of that yellowtail at Catalina. That's a big, giant, massive school on four different spots back there. But it's focused on the squid, and unfortunately right now no one's selling squid, but I'm sure pretty soon the squid boats will be out there selling it. There's a little bit of squid in the middle of the backside of the island. I know Mark talked about it yesterday a little bit. Dave Hansen blew that thing up, but there's a bunch of stuff going on. And then Aliar, that was going to happen. He went down there and had a pretty spectacular hit on those bluefin. We all knew it was going to happen as soon as he took the boat off the dock. And then, like Brian Woolley said, the water's 61 degrees in most places, and the calico bass are very excited to get on your lures or on your bait. It's just looking like it's going to be the El Nino that we've all dreamt of. This is going to be the one. So make sure you get your reservations in early. You want to get on a boat. You want to go fishing. Everything's going to start happening tomorrow, because the show ends today and everybody's going fishing tomorrow.
Yeah, everybody's pumped up after seeing all that great gear and the boats and all the great stuff at the PCS show today. And you'll be doing your show today at what time?
Myself, Ali Husseini, and Dave Marciano are going to be on the stage.
What?
So that ought to be pretty exciting.
Crazy.
To see
how cool.
Yeah, we're going to be up there on the stage. I'll see if I have a chance to let it wasn't Todd's emceeing it, and Dave Hansen and Todd on stage. I hope we give Marciano and a little bit of oxygen to talk.
Yeah, and the bleep button.
Yeah, for sure. Well, and what time is that seminar, Dave?
4 o'clock, I believe. I'm not positive.
And the show ends.
Don't know. I'm
from
my booth right
today,
next to the main.
Right?
Yes, it's over at 5 o'clock today.
All right, so get over there at the Orange County Fairgrounds. Go see your saltwater guide, Captain Dave. And if they miss you today, how do we find you, Dave?
Guys, check me out at Your Saltwater Guide on every social media platform, and I'll be back on the show next Sunday talking about how much fun we had fishing this week.
All right. Sounds great, Dave. Thanks. Save that voice, and we'll talk to you next Sunday. And, of course, fishdope.com has all the information you need. Now is the time to really stay abreast of that. $20 off a new membership to fishdope.com using the code HOOKUPNOW. Lowercase, no space. HOOKUPNOW is your $20 code, or $30 code, excuse me.
Yeah, $30.
You save $30 now at fishdope.com. All right.
And I'd like to remind you, too, if you like fishing for tuna and you're not using gamakatsu hooks, you're missing bites. The Nautilus Circle Hook comes in sizes as small as a number 4 to a 6-aught. And if you're into big fish, Nautilus HD is tough enough, but not oversized. Both come with a ring or no ring. See your local dealer or check gamakatsu.com. And we're going to be right back on Let's Talk Hook Up. More with Sean Sullivan. All these cool stories.
Yeah.
I want to hear more about Mag Bay, man. That's super cool.
That sounds cool.
We're going to be right back on Let's Talk Hook Up app, the Mightier 1090 ESPN Radio.
Hey, we're so lucky here in San Diego. We have fantastic weather and great fishing. We also have 3 great shops to take care of anglers. Hi, this is Ben, and you will see me at my dad's shop, Dana Landing in Mission Bay. We call it the one-stop shop for a great day on the water because it truly is. Food, bait, tackle, beverages, and more. Our tackle shop, headed by Johnny, is certainly one of the best. We have you covered from bay bass to big tuna. Plus, we have Doug, one of the finest reel repair guys around. For freshwater tackle, nothing beats East County Bait and Tackle. Jeet and the guys have the best rod and reels, the hottest lures, and live bait. Our newest shop is Lemon Grove Bait and Tackle, growing their stock of both fresh and saltwater tackle right in the heart of Lemon Grove. ECBT is at the end of the 67 freeway on Maple View and Lakeside. Lemon Grove Bait and Tackle, 94 to Broadway in Lemon Grove. And Dana Landing is next to the Dana Lawn Tramp in Mission Bay. Check danalanding.com for more details.
Everyone has their go-to fishing spot. My spot is Kingfisher Charters in Sitka, Alaska. Rockcod Rick here to say if you're looking for the ultimate Alaska experience and the best value in Alaska, it's Kingfisher Charters. Owner Seth Bone and his crew consistently deliver deluxe accommodations, the finest food, world-class fish processing, and top-of-the-line fishing experience. We've literally sent hundreds of our listeners to Kingfisher, and they all can't wait to go back. Most Alaska resorts make big promises, and they don't deliver, or they'll nickel and dime you to drive up the cost, but not Kingfisher. Everything is included. Your license, fish processing, super deluxe accommodations, amazing food, airport transfers, your gear. Literally all you need to bring is your layer clothing, and Kingfisher covers the rest. They also have the finest boats and charter captains in Sitka, all for the ultimate value. Take it from me. Book your trip to Kingfisher Charters and you'll thank me. Kingfisher Charters, 800-727-6136, or check kingfishercharters.com.
Here's the hot tip on the best fishing L.A. has to offer, 22nd Street Landing Sport Fishing in San Pedro. They are home to L.A.'s finest open party fleet, including Overnight on the Freedom, Catalina Freelance on the Pursuit, half-day trips on the Monte Carlo, and three-quarter-day trips on the Sea Angler. For your own private charter, we have the Outrider and True Line available. There's always plenty of free parking and a fully stocked tackle store. 22nd Street Landing Sport Fishing in San Pedro. Call 310-832-8304 or on the web at 22ndstreet.com.
It's time for the PowerPro 30-second seminar. I like catching big fish, and I like smaller reels, too. How do I make sure that I have the capacity to land the big one? I fill my reels with PowerPro Max Quattro. It's 25% thinner than standard PowerPro, so you get more line on that small reel. PowerPro has a complete series of highly effective lines, including the brand-new PowerPro Depth Hunter Offshore, with different colors every 100 feet, perfect for flatfall fishing. Want to learn more? Check PowerPro.com.
For quality, the Islander out of Fisherman's Landing is a favorite among anglers. But Islander Charters is much more than great fishing. The quality of the captains and crew, as well as the great meals and service, speak for themselves. Comfortable staterooms, a super clean and well-taken care of boat, are just a few of the reasons the Islander is so popular. The Islander specializes in 1.5 to 5 day fishing. Experience the Islander difference. Visit IslanderSportFishing.com.
All right, welcome back to Let's Talk Hookup. You hear us talking about all kinds of cool stuff.
That Mag Bay story just got everybody jazzed up.
Fired
sure,
her, man.
Yeah, for sure. And we want to get through. Still time, 213-432-1090. Lots of texts and lots of calls, and we appreciate that. You have a chance to win that beautiful book,
Drawn to Water, which I can't believe it's only $49.95 at Amazon.
Well, now that you say that, I'm going to have to raise the price.
Wait a week so our listeners can grab it. Yeah.
Probably sometime as we get closer to summer, the price will probably go up. So if they get in there in the next 30 days or so, I definitely will keep the price under $50.
It's a legit book,
And
the photography is out of this world. Yeah. Like, Ron in Carlsbad asks, hey, thanks, guys, for unique content. Love the change of pace. It's a quick question for Sean. I'm looking at the book now and have added it to my birthday wish list, but would like to know what's the next book, and have you done any diving photography?
You know, I don't have scuba certification. I have thought about it. I've done a lot of snorkeling. You know, if I was going to do another book right now, I might do a book, another fishing book, because the stories that I put in here are only half of what I had. I have so much more. But you can only fit it so much in there. If I put any more stories in, the book starts to get so expensive to produce that I can't even buy author copies for myself. It's like every time you add a few pages, the price goes up. So I had to limit it. I actually took a couple stories out to try to keep it down well below 300 pages. But I do have more stories, and I continue to travel. One thing I wanted to mention is, I love more than anything my whole existence, and this is probably why I took on fishing photography, was because obviously I love to fish. I love getting out there. I love going to these amazing places. But to do that, to travel the world these days, it's expensive. And so you need to, have a brand that you're working with. I've worked with a lot of the brands out there, but there's so many more that I would love to work with. So I'm looking for any opportunity I can to go to a wild place, shoot photos for any of these companies that want people to come out and have somebody, come out and shoot photos for them. Whatever it takes for me to get on the plane and get to the water, I am drawn to water regardless of whether it's Southern Hemisphere.
Yeah.
I would love to
An opportunity for somebody that wants to get some great photos and promote their business. Wow.
Yeah, so hopefully another book will come out. I have more stories, but even since this book has come out, I've done a couple more trips that would make for great stories. And, there's that story in the new PCS magazine, the 11th day that just came out. It's the issue that's at the PCS show right now.
Yep.
Lot of effort and work went into that story.
Great story.
Yeah, it talks a lot about
great photos.
How the long range thing is kind of in flux, how the waters are warming around here. The species are moving, they're migrating. Bluefin are moving north. Dorado are coming up here in huge numbers. There's a lot of change going on right now in the both in the environment and in the fleet here in San Diego. And so this story aims to sort of capture a lot of that. That evolution right now.
Yeah. And cycles. I mean, the ocean travels in cycles. Everything on this earth travels in cycles.
Absolutely.
Right?
Yeah. You have another great text.
I do, Pete. Yes. Good morning, guys. Cool show today. And he says the same thing. $49. What a deal for all the adventure and the hard work, Sean. And he says, do you ever photo freshwater species? And if so, what and where? Thanks. That's from Jeff in Huntington Beach.
I'm so glad somebody asked this question, because there are some things that I cover here that are freshwater. In the book, there's a couple stories. One of them is with my buddy Nigel Wheeler. He does Double Down Sport Fishing on Lake Tahoe, and he is an amazing captain, an amazing angler. He fishes big Mackinac. He fishes for kokanee salmon, and he also targets trophy rainbows and brown trout. This is Lake Tahoe, so it's full of these trout. But I mean, he gets huge fish, and he's just one of the nicest guys. He's taking bookings all summer coming up. Definitely someone you want to, if you're going to be in Tahoe and you want to go up there and check it out, he's definitely someone to talk to. It's Double Down Sport Fishing. So I love fishing Tahoe. It's a beautiful area. I love fishing trout up there, especially fly fishing. I don't do a lot of fly fishing on saltwater, but I love doing that in the high mountain streams. Higher elevation, the better. And the other thing, too, that I love doing in freshwater is when I was working in Florida for a while, there's a huge bass angler population in Florida. They're really big into their largemouth
here
bass.
Too. Come on, yeah. Don't down us.
No, don't. Yeah. Well, yeah, but
it's just a huge fishery back
there.
It's
a huge fishery, but there is a sort of this east versus west competition going on, and it's really interesting. The Cali guys are always saying, "Yeah, but the bigger fish are here," and those Florida guys are angling to. And I use that word angling.
I think the egos travel with the size too.
Absolutely, but there are some big fish in Florida. But one of the things things I wanted to mention was snakehead fishing.
Oh.
When I was working in Florida, one of the things I did out there a bunch with my buddy Jim, who he owns Drave Lures. He's not one of the owners. He's the California rep for Drave, which is, I believe they're from Thailand or somewhere overseas. But they specialize in snakehead lures, these hollow-bodied frogs and these poppers and stuff like this. And Florida has a massive snakehead population.
Invasive, by the way.
Well, they are invasive. And there was a huge thing for a while about how snakeheads were going to, like, wipe out all these species and all this. And I actually wrote a story for Florida Sport Fishing Magazine about this, about how misunderstood the snakehead is. That's not to say that the snakehead hasn't eaten some bass fry and sort of taken over some of the environments. But, you know, Mother Nature has a tendency to adapt and to, you know.
Maybe strengthen in some ways.
Very much so. Yeah. You know, it helps the gene pool get stronger. And, you know, I've caught plenty of bass down there while we're fishing for snakeheads, and I've caught snakeheads around the bass and vice versa. Guaranteed the bass eat plenty of snakehead fry when they're all in their feeding. So those fish have all learned to adapt, and I personally haven't. I've caught plenty of bass. But the snakehead in particular are a freshwater species that have to be probably one of my favorite things to target. You know, I always like to say when it comes to sport fishing in particular, you have your easy objectives and you have your really hard objectives or expert objectives. You know, targeting yellowfin tuna on a big tuna boil with a live bait, it's really easy. You throw your bait out there. If they're boiling and they're feeding frenzy going on, you're going
to
get them.
But you're saying snakeheads are tough to catch.
Snakeheads are absolutely an expert objective. You got to be on it. You got to dial your technique. There's a lot of minutia involved. And even then, these fish are so wily. They sit right up against the bank. They usually face up and waiting for a frog to drop down the bank or something like that. They're extremely smart. They're very sensitive to their surroundings. And you can.
Oh, I see Corey lathering right now. He wants to go catch a snakehead on a frog.
You can see
that.
Yeah, I'm into it.
For sure.
You can throw 1,000 casts and get one bite. And,
Crazy.
You really got to be on it. It took me a while to catch them. And, I caught a few, but nothing like my friends who are like expert snakehead guys. You do a bit of snakehead fishing, and I swear to God, it becomes an obsession. Other things that.
That's cool. Hey, I just got a great text from our friend Valerie at Queen Charlotte Safari.
Okay.
She's texting up from the PCS show. She'll be there in her booth today. And she said that two spots just opened up on your trip to Queen Charlotte Safaris, August 7th through 11th. It's been sold out for months. Two people that were on that trip had to move to a later date because of conflict.
Okay.
So if you want to go on the Queen Charlotte Safaris Let's Talk Hookup trip with Corey, August 7th to 11th, go by and see Valerie today at the PCS show, or text her at 805-698-9590. You will love that trip. And, of course, don't forget, Valerie will be in the studio here in the World Headquarters next Sunday to talk about that beautiful pace that we actually told Sean to go by and check her out.
If Valerie needs a photographer with the, with the spot open.
Oh, she needs you up there.
I am dying to come up there and shoot. I have shot in Elfin Cove a bit, but I would love to go to her area and get some shots of what they do up there. That's one of the areas that is glaringly missing from this book. Alaska deserves to be in this book.
Yeah, absolutely.
Haida Gwaii is
one of the most beautiful places on earth. Hey, Corey, let's jump into the phones.
Let's do it. How about Arnie? Arnie Combe from Vista. Good morning, Arnie.
Hey, good morning, guys. How you doing today?
Hi, Arnie.
This is a very interesting show this morning. It's like you haven't had somebody like this, like Gary Graham, I mean, really, since office photography. Sean, thank you for all the technical aspects you've brought to the show this morning. It's been very interesting. The question I have for you, for a guy like me who's like, I'm pretty much an amateur guy that's kind of do little things here and there, how hard is it to break in to try to get into submit stuff to magazines or like Western Outdoor News?
You know, I haven't had many photos, if any, in Western Outdoor News. I have talked to them a little bit. The magazines, though, you know, here's one of the things I try to tell people when they want to submit their photos to a magazine is one of the easiest ways to get your stuff published is to create a turnkey content is what I call it. Basically, you write a story. You provide the photos. You basically hand them something that requires very little work for them to do. All they have to do is transcribe the words and lay out the photos, and it's done. Whereas if you're sending them photos and they need to find someone to write a story like that, the odds of getting the photos in the mag kind of go down at that point. By giving them content that they can easily run without too much additional work.
Plug and play, man. They're ready to go.
Plug and play is the way to go. Yeah. So if you can, if you have an experience, a trip that you take or something like that, I would advise people to go in planning ahead that I'm going to write a story about this. I'm going to have this experience. And then when I get home, I'm going to produce this article. I'm going to take great photos. I'm going to edit my photos really tight, get them down to, you know, 20 or 30 of the very best photos that I get from the trip and submit that around. And, you know, someone's going to bite on it. If the content's good and the words, you know, work, you know, it's a no-brainer that someone would pick up a story like that.
You make it sound so easy, Sean. And, yeah. And it is. I'm in the fishing.
Well,
I'm into the
trip.
Art
is a good photographer, too, so he can pull it off.
Yeah. But doing the adventure and then setting aside the moment to take the pictures isn't always hand-in-hand.
Yeah. No, you know, it does take some premeditation to make sure that you get the shots. You know, you got to go in there with some intention. I'm going to come here. I'm going to get photos. I'm really going to focus on trying to get the shots that I want. And we're also going to try to get the big fish. That's another thing too, is, you know, you'll go on these trips and you'll have a target species and a target shot in mind, but that, there's no guarantees. I mean, this is fishing.
Yeah.
You know, so.
Well, it sounds like Arnie needs to buy your book Money Shot.
Yeah.
Because that's something that probably would help. He'd learn some
Absolutely.
Techniques there. Yeah.
There's a lot of techniques in there. And, you know, one of the biggest things I emphasize in that book is the importance of luck. You know, you gotta get everything kind of working in your favor to, you know, and it goes back to really catching the big fish, getting the light, things like this. You know, if you plan ahead and, you know, you do your homework, you know, you're going to come out with good shots. And
one thing I learned, I was on an Indonesian scuba diving trip in January and shot about 2,000 photos.
Yes.
And I ended up with probably 50 good ones, right?
Yes.
Is that something that you need to do? Just shoot a lot of photos.
Absolutely.
And that's the advantage of digital, right?
100%. So, you know, I taught photography for a few years for Sierra Nevada College up in Tahoe. I did a couple summers with them, and I was teaching down in Argentina in Bariloche. We did a summer program.
Oh, cool.
Yeah, if you ever get a chance to go to Bariloche.
I've been there. It's wonderful.
Incredible. It's the gateway to Patagonia.
I want in on that class.
Yeah.
That's
awesome. But the course I taught was called Winter Adventure Photography, and they were trying to, you know, have the course expand beyond just my snowboarding photos, but the snowboarding was the emphasis at the time. Bariloche is an incredible place. I taught American college students for two summers while I was down there. But one of the first things I tell them is that photography is a numbers game, period. The more photos you shoot, the better chance you have of getting gold out of your shots. You shoot 10 photos, you're going to have maybe one great photo. You shoot 1,000 photos, that one best photo is going to be 10 times better than if you shot less photos. The more shots you get, the better photos
percentage
you're going to get.
Percentage,
yeah. It is, absolutely
100%. So when you're using your digital SLR, are you putting it on click, 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 click? It's like shooting multiple frames at the same time? Or you...
It is. But or, you know, I also try to make the frames count, too. You know, when I say shoot 2,000 photos, it doesn't necessarily imply to just go out and, you know, just randomly shoot blindly of everything. You really want to, you know, shoot with intention and shoot with a focus in mind and try to frame your photos. Always look through the camera. You know, one thing.
So make each photo count.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
And one of the things that really sounds cool too is that 20 millimeter lens. That sounds like a really important tool to have in your quiver.
It is. The beauty of the 20 is if you go any wider than that, like 16 or stuff, you start to get some real distortion.
Mm-hmm.
If you go any less wide than that, you start to cut off the edges and it's really hard to get these bigger fish in there. So the 20 is a great balance between, you know, a little bit of distortion.
And it's not a zoom, it's just a straight 20.
The one I have is an 18 to 35 is what I've been using these days. So it's not technically just a 20, but I generally shoot around 20. I find 18 to be a little bit too wide, and I find 35 to be not wide enough.
Gotcha.
But I like having the flexibility of the zoom. It's one of the higher price zooms, so it's 18 to 35, 2.8, I think is what it is. So it still gives you a lot of room for light.
Yeah.
But you have a lot of flexibility on the
system. So crazy. So technical.
Yeah, I mean, that's like, but having the right tools makes all the difference in the world.
You know, let me add one more thing, too. If you want to bypass all that, these days, some of the best shots come off your phone. I mean, if you got an iPhone or an Android or something like that, there's absolutely nothing wrong with getting out there and shooting.
Some high-quality stuff.
Oh, yeah, you can shoot. You know, some phones these days have 48-megapixel shots.
Yeah.
I mean, the photos I get on my iPhone are incredible. You know, my buddy Renee on the Excel, Renee Sanchez, great guy, incredible deckhand, one of the best guys I've worked with. He has become such a great photographer with phones. phones. I mean, I'm constantly handing him my phone, and he takes these photos. I mean, he's got some photos here in the book that he took with my phone that are like,
that's so cool,
incredible. Yeah.
And mentioning the book, somebody's going to win that.
Yeah,
and
for
we're going to be right back on Let's Talk Hookup. We're going to find out. We're going to flip the coin and find out whether it's a text or a caller winning this book. We're going to be right back on Let's Talk Hookup app, the Mightier 1090 ESPN Radio.
The PCS show is coming, and we will have an awesome display at the show. Hi, this is Doug Kern from Fisherman's Landing Tackle. Check us out in the wildly popular saltwater building at the PCS show at the OC Fairgrounds in Costa Mesa, where we will feature the Shimano lineup of rods, reels, and lures, like Talica reels, Terramar rods, and the Hot Current Sniper lures. And as always, our expert staff will help you select that perfect Shimano setup for the fish you want to pursue. For saltwater tackle at the PCS show, your best shop is the Fisherman's Landing Tackle booth. The name that stands out among anglers is Fisherman's Landing, your top choice in local and long-range fishing. We offer the finest open party trips from 1 to 3 days, the best charter boats available, and of course, our world-renowned long-range fleet. Fisherman's Landing offers half-day trips on the Dolphin and full-day trips on the Liberty. Many trips can be easily booked online at fishermanslanding.com. I'll see you at Fisherman's Landing in San Diego.
This is Captain Tim Ekstrom from the long-range vessel Royal Star. With my partners Randy Toussaint and Brian Sims, we have set the bar for the long-range fishing experience. Spring 8-day, summer 5-day, or a fly-down, fly-back 11-day winter trip, we deliver the highest quality long-range voyage you will find. From our premium RSW fish storage to our top-of-the-line chefs and crew, Royal Star distinguishes itself from all others. Want to grab a spot on the Royal Star? Check us out at RoyalStarSportFishing.com or call Tracy at 619-224-4764.
In San Diego, the future belongs to everyone. So Ford engineered the truck of the future for everyone, the Ford F-150, available with a Pro Power onboard generator. What a great addition for anglers. There's also a variety of cab configurations for whatever you need to haul. The truck of the future isn't created for just a few. It's created for us who love the ocean and the outdoor life. Ford F-150. Test drive one at your local San Diego County Ford dealer today. They'll be glad to hook you up.
For your next fishing adventure, check Point Loma Sport Fishing. They offer half-day trips on the Daily Double and full-day trips on the Mission Bell every day. Perfect for novice or seasoned fishermen. Point Loma Sport Fishing also offers overnight to multi-day trips on the American Angler, Vagabond, Intrepid, Independence, Gew Loan, T-Bird, Game Changer, and more. Visit PointLomaSportFishing.com where you can purchase tickets online. Want to go fishing? Point Loma Sport Fishing has you covered.
All right, we're back on Let's Talk Hookup. We're going to find out who's won Sean Sullivan's book called Drawn to Water. Go ahead and flip the coin.
We're flipping the coin.
Yep. Oh, texter. And the texter happens to be Norm from San Diego.
Wow, Norm.
We're
going to
personally sign the book for you.
Yeah, Norm from San Diego. Norman from San Diego.
Norman.
Hey, thanks, Sean. This went so fast. So much to cover. And you have some kudos to throw out there.
Yeah, you know, it's a real honor to be here with you guys. I mean, you know, this show has been, you know, on the radar for ever, you know, and to actually show up here and be able to be on the show, it's really cool. I want to send a shout out to Mike Keebler. He's the guy who connected me with you. Keebler's a great guy. He was on the Spirit of Adventure with us. Thanks. I also want to send a shout out to the guys I know, Pescador, Larry Leonetti and his family, Angela. They run trips down there for giant tuna. They're in Puerto Vallarta. They're awesome. My buddy Ralph Falcon out in Florida. He's a great angler and a real friend. Ron from Pelagic. You know, he gave me an opportunity when no one else would, and I'm so grateful to him. And
pretty cool, man.
Yeah, and also to Bob Woodard, who's out there, him and his
Woodard.
Dad. Yeah,
Woodard Jr.,
the man.
Local legends. I want to send a big shout out to them.
Yeah. And you know, we got to have you back. SullyPhotos.com, SullyPhotos.com.
That is the website.
Get the book on Amazon, right? It's called Drawn to Water.
Yep.
And then you'll be doing your book signing tomorrow.
Melton Tackle.
4 to 6 p.m. at Melton's Tackle in Orange County. Hey, thanks to everybody out there tomorrow or next week. Captain Tim and Alex from the Royal Star. And next Sunday, Valerie Hope Red from Queen Charlotte Safari.